It is a story that spans almost 4,000 years. A story of the oldest document of Western civilization, with a message that is timeless and mysterious. The Egyptian Book of the Dead is the ancient Egyptians' guide to the afterlife, and it may well be the world's first religious document. From the controversial archaeologist who plots to smuggle it out of Egypt,
I will not tolerate any deviation from the law, either by you or by your native friends.
To a terrifying journey into the afterlife itself. The Egyptian Book of the Dead is a story as old as civilization. The first vision of Judgment Day. A book that may answer the ultimate questions that humanity has asked for millennia. Mummies. They are the mysterious remnants of one of history's oldest civilizations. They hint at vast expanses of time and of secrets wrapped deep within their ancient shrouds. They are so familiar, yet so alien. A frightening reminder of our own mortality. Yet a tantalizing promise of immortality. The mummy is only the remnant of a far greater mystery, the tip of the iceberg. The ancient Egyptians believed in a vast and intricate afterlife. Each mummified corpse is expected to resurrect in another world, and there is only one guide to that world, the Egyptian Book of the Dead. It is the name given to scrolls entombed with the mummified dead in ancient Egypt.
The Book of the Dead was a kind of guidebook for the deceased and a book of spells and to aid the deceased in his journey through the afterlife and the process of becoming immortal.
It was certainly a book of magic. It's a collection of spells, the chief purpose of which is to enable life after death and immortality to the deceased.
It is a book for the dead because it tells us about what the dead will face in the afterlife. This is why we call it the Book of the Dead. It is very important because this is a quest of immortality.
Some have said the ancient Egyptians cared more about their life after death than their life on Earth. This must have been the case for those who lived in the ancient city of Thebes in the 19th dynasty over 3,000 years ago. This is the story of one Egyptian whom history only records as Ani. Ani lived during a high point of Egyptian culture, known as the New Kingdom. From the year 1600 BCE to 1200 BCE, brilliant military pharaohs conquer lands from Nubia to Syria. Pharaohs like Ramses and Seti built enormous palaces and lavish religious temples. Ani enjoys one of the highest standards of living in ancient Egyptian history. It is perhaps only in these historic periods of relative prosperity that a civilization begins to contemplate questions of philosophy, life, and the afterlife. It is clear from the historical record that the afterlife must have weighed heavily on Ani's mind. The idea of dying without proper preparation for the next world could jeopardize one's chances for eternal paradise.
وعندنا ناح عنك.
بختليتي الشغوت
Iwas nuha. Nana herir eterimosig nachnuch.
The evidence of Ani's obsession with the afterlife is this extraordinary piece of funeral art known as the Scroll of Ani.
The Scroll of Ani is rightly one of the most famous copies of the Book of the Dead because of the high quality of the artistry. The writing, and especially the beautifully painted vignettes, are really among the most impressive of any of the Books of the Dead that have survived.
Archaeologists have uncovered more than 25,000 copies of the Egyptian Book of the Dead, the oldest text dating from 1500 BCE, the latest dating from the 4th century AD. But it is here at the famed British Museum in the heart of 21st century London that one can see the famous Scroll of Ani, the finest example of the Egyptian Book of the Dead ever preserved. Painted approximately in the year 1250 BCE, it contains 65 prayers and magical spells and over 150 colorful illustrations. This exquisite piece of work is one of the longest scrolls ever discovered. When unrolled, it measures an incredible 78 feet. But the way in which the museum acquired this masterpiece is filled with intrigue and controversy. The scroll was brought from Egypt in 1887 by a museum employee named Ernest Alfred Thompson Wallace Budge. He was a prolific author, writing over 100 books on Egyptology, most of which are still in print. He published some of the first translations of important Egyptian texts. He collected thousands of artifacts that have been acknowledged as some of the finest examples of ancient art. Yet there are those who say Budge was a second-rate scholar, a poor archaeologist, and a cultural thief, acquiring antiquities by any means possible.
He was out there, well, basically looting and pillaging and buying up what he could.
People apply cultural judgments which are totally out of time. The fact that he took materials out of ancient cultures for its day was quite normal.
You can't look at him from a modern point of view. You know, this is he's a cultural thief. This is not the way they looked at it in those days. But on the other hand, he did sail very close to the wind.
I think he was a thief. Because, you know, you can be an honest man all your life, but if you steal something, you become a thief.
Though Budge is controversial today, in his lifetime, he is a respected translator and one of the finest curators of the British Museum. In the fall of 1887, they send him to Egypt to collect artifacts. Trip to Egypt is timed perfectly. Shortly after his arrival, news of newly discovered artifacts begin to surface, which he notes in his autobiography.
Before I'd been in Cairo many hours, I found that everyone was talking about the discoveries made in Upper Egypt when the most extraordinary stories were afloat. Rumors of the finds had reached all the great cities of Europe. And there were representatives of several continental museums in Cairo, each doing his best to secure the lion's share.
Budge's first stop, the Egyptian Museum, to meet a fellow Egyptologist. He is shocked by the shabby state of the museum's collection.
The scarab is supposed to give its owner immortality. In this place, it's lucky if the scarab itself lasts 6 months.
Egypt doesn't have the resources that the great European museums have, Mr. Budge.
But you think at least you could dust the place? You think at least they could keep the treasure from water damage?
Well, hopefully the new director will help change that.
Ah, the famous Monsieur Grabeau.
Overseeing the recovery and preservation of all Egyptian artifacts is the new head of colonial antiquities, a Frenchman named Eugène Grabeau.
Monsieur Grabeau would argue that the British Museum is just another thief smuggling away Egypt's heritage.
Sounds just like a Frenchman.
Mr. Budge, يا سيدي, تعلمت كلمة الكنز من لوكسور.
Treasure in Luxor? That doesn't sound like archaeology to me.
Emil, I'd like you to meet my assistant, Ramshi.
مرحبا.
You're not planning on doing anything illegal, are you?
Of course not.
Purchasing antiquities is a theft.
It's not a theft. As long as Egypt treats its treasures like this, its preservation. Good day, Emil.
Today, Ernest Wallace Budge has a bad reputation. But in 1887, he is less interested in reputation than he is in getting to the reputed new discovery. 450 miles from his base in Cairo to Luxor, Budge is determined to reach this treasure before other collectors. His competitive instinct serves him well, for among these artifacts is a window to another world, one that modern man has never seen. The discovery of the Scroll of Ani is one of Egyptology's greatest stories. An adventure involving conspiracy, intrigue, and a controversial hero, Ernest A. Wallace Budge. In 1887, Budge is in Egypt to collect artifacts for the British Museum.
I received information from a native in Egypt that some very important discoveries in Thebes had been made. He told me that a tomb had been found on the western bank of the Nile, which was the best he'd ever seen, and that there were in it several rolls of papyrus. He urged me to come without delay and to take possession of all these things before the authorities could seize them and cast their owners into prison.
The late 19th century was a really dynamic time in the history of Egyptology. On the one hand, you had the emergence of modern archaeology, but at the same time, you had the old, long-standing tradition of looting, of even mining sites by antiquities dealers.
Budge rarely excavated antiquities from tombs. He preferred to buy them from dealers. This thriving black market led to an extraordinary collection for the British Museum. But it also helped destroy some of Egypt's archaeological treasures.
Then the black market for selling antiquities was very bad. Egypt was raped. We call it the rape of the Nile. They raped the Nile. They took this heritage out of the country, and it's now everywhere.
Budge's assistant has led him to a black market antiquities dealer, where he's been given an intriguing artifact that was found in Luxor.
He protecteth the weak against the strong, and he heareth the cry of him that is bound in fetters.
In 1887, Budge is one of the few Westerners who can read hieroglyphics.
It is real, yes?
Yes, I'd say it's very real. It's a description of the sun god Ra. It's 18th dynasty. I would venture to say that this is from a copy of the Book of the Dead. I call it the Bible of the Egyptians. It's the oldest religious text in the world.
Surely not older than the Bible.
Indeed it is. In fact, this piece seems to be from the so-called negative confessions. This was a list of sins one should not commit. The real source of the Ten Commandments. Mahmoud?
Yes?
Is this the only piece of papyrus?
Oh, no. The man who found it, the man who found the scroll, he cut it into small pieces to sell it to collectors. I have no more.
But this is from the new discovery.
Yes.
I have someone bring you to the man who found it. He is in Luxor.
The problem with black market antiquities is that people wind up stealing things and taking them out of their context. Whether it was done in the 1800s or today, it is equally bad. By doing this, you completely destroy any understanding one has of the object.
It's a pleasure, as always, Mahmoud. You still prefer British pounds, I take it?
Of course, Mr. Budge. I have a guide waiting for you tomorrow morning. It is a 2 days' ride.
We'll be ready.
Budge intends to get to the new discoveries, but he is well aware that the new director of antiquities, Eugène Grabeau, is trying to get there first. In 1887, Budge knows that the rumored find of papyrus scrolls is important. But the true historic value of the Book of the Dead is only now being understood. Many believe it is the oldest example of religious writing in the world.
You can see things are written in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and Quran. And therefore, religion today doesn't come suddenly. There is stages. The Book of the Dead is really the first stage of the human thinking about the afterlife.
Book of the Dead has its earliest antecedents in the oldest religious text we have from ancient Egypt, the pyramid texts. And these were inscribed on pyramids during the 5th dynasty around 2300 BC.
Later, royal and noble Egyptians are choosing to have those same pyramid inscriptions written inside their coffins. And that set of texts are known as the coffin texts. Then, by the time of the New Kingdom, which was a tremendous research in literary and artistic production, we find mortuary literature that begins to gather all the spells from the coffins and write them into a papyrus roll that can be buried with your mummy.
In 1250 BCE, during the lifetime of the scribe Ani, the spells in the Book of the Dead would already be over 1,000 years old. We know from the historical record that Ani was a temple scribe. Today he might be considered an accountant.
We find out that he is a royal scribe. He is in charge of tallying the accounts of all of the offerings made to the gods.
Temples were both religious institutions, but also major economic ones. And he was in charge of offerings, but also of granaries of the temple.
Ani's position as scribe tells us that he was part of an educated group within the Egyptian elite. Ani must have been deeply concerned about his place in the afterlife. Eternity can only be guaranteed by owning a Book of the Dead.
The Book of the Dead was probably created in an institution called the House of Life, which was a place connected with great temple complexes where religious learning was promoted. This is where new rituals were designed, myths were created or at least elaborated on, and funeral texts were generated.
Ani would have met with a priest at one of the temples to inquire about the Book of the Dead.
There were two ways of getting a Book of the Dead. One was you commissioned one especially, and therefore probably paid a premium price to have a very high quality one that was designed for you precisely from the very outset. We also know that quite a lot of Books of the Dead were made without indicating who they belonged to. The name of the owner, which is repeated throughout any Book of the Dead, is actually left blank. So that when somebody came along and said they wanted one, they would simply write in the name of the new owner of it, and then it would be ready to be placed in his or her tomb.
Temple complexes in the New Kingdom are places of worship and of business.
Yachin tevenat nua.
Is. Amatzachonait.
Namit achaknu bahar achuknuhim. Tambaha shofet borde. Itach manorea guriamcha.
An Egyptian scroll begins as a stalk of the papyrus plant, which grows plentifully along the Nile. The stems are stripped of their outer rinds, then laid in thin strips and pounded together into thin sheets. In a dry climate like Egypt's, papyrus is extremely stable, lasting for thousands of years without any deterioration. The next step in constructing a Book of the Dead would be the writing of the spells.
The scribal profession was one of the most esteemed in the ancient world. They controlled knowledge, and knowledge is power. Now, the scribe didn't get to be a scribe by accident. It took years of rigorous training, starting with small boys who were sent to scribal schools at the temples or in the royal palace. They spent years and years mastering the thousands of symbols in the hieroglyphic language. In ancient Egypt, language is itself magical. It has the power to create. It is very much like the idea in the Gospel of John, that in the beginning is the Word, that there is this primal principle of language, which is certainly part of the Book of the Dead's whole point. It aims to create a blessed afterlife.
The final point in creating the Book of the Dead would be painting the individual pictures, or vignettes. They believe that these images had a magical power, enough to determine a man's destiny.
It's all part of this manufacturing process. You can see this sort of mass production mode of really confecting, assembling a Book of the Dead according to order.
Purchasing a Book of the Dead would have affected Ani's entire family.
It was quite expensive, perhaps a half a year's wage for a person of, let's say, Ani's status.
The ancient records reveal that Ani's wife was named Tutu. The couple must have had many discussions regarding the Book of the Dead. The choice was difficult for a family in the new kingdom, to provide for the present or eternity. Ani's quest for the Book of the Dead will make his name famous in modern times, but not before Wallace Budge gets some attention of his own.
I assure you, I make a very unpleasant enemy.
It has been said that ancient Egypt was a culture of death. Very little is left of ancient Egyptian daily life, but we know a great deal about them because of the lavish attention they devoted to their tombs, their treasures, their scrolls, and even their mummified corpses. Today, the religion of the pharaohs is meeting the technology of the 21st century. In an unprecedented study, Egyptologists are applying cutting-edge medical science to 3,000-year-old mummies. The digital technology allows Egyptologists to virtually unwrap mummies without harming these precious treasures.
Yeah, they even have the false ear.
Beneath the wrapping, a 2,000-year-old amulet protects the deceased from the dangers of the afterlife.
Now, when they were wrapping the body, they also put amulets, protective amulets, all around the body, both in the front and also in the back. That would help the body achieve an afterlife. And what's quite nice is that some of these amulets are tied into things in the Book of the Dead. So you know that they are there to protect the body against specific perils that they're going to meet on the way through to the other side of the afterlife.
Let's see, the mask was on.
But why did the ancient Egyptians go through the trouble of preserving their dead to begin with?
The ancient Egyptians mummified their dead because they believed that the soul really needed a more physical vehicle to enjoy all of the sort of physical delights of the afterlife. And so they used to mummify bodies, which meant preserving them so that they could be used by the soul to go back into the body, which would be perfectly preserved, and then could enjoy, you know, food, drink, anything else that the afterlife had to offer.
But mummifying a body was not an easy process.
What the embalmers would do is remove all the internal organs, the lungs, the liver, the stomach, and the intestines.
The organs were placed in ceremonial jars, known as canopic jars. They would later be entombed with the body. Next, a long hook was used to pull the brain out through the nose. The ancient Egyptians did not believe the brain was an essential organ.
You can actually see the defect is right here, where they go in through the nose, punched a hole in the floor of the skull to remove the brain.
Once the brain had been removed, they would melt resins and pour the liquid resin through the nostril and sort of roll the head around so that the cranium was coated. This was done so that they could prevent bacterial growth in the cranium.
The heart is the only organ that would stay within the body. It was thought to be the center of intelligence and feeling. And they would need those in the afterlife.
They would wash the body out, dry it using natron, which is a kind of a salt and baking soda kind of mixture. And after 40 days of desiccation had elapsed, they would put oil and unguent on the body and then wrap it with great ceremony rituals. And that would be the end of mummification, and it would be buried.
But mummification was just the beginning to a long journey. A journey for the soul of the deceased. And the Egyptian Book of the Dead was the only guide to a life beyond the grave. Somewhere near the year 1250 BCE, an Egyptian scribe named Ani became concerned about the afterlife. He believes the Book of the Dead can offer some peace of mind.
When you die, and you are getting to the afterlife, the way, the journey in between is very perilous. And the deceased spirit, before they were reborn forever, had to go through a series of tests. And the Book of the Dead provides answers and protection against the perils of the journey.
This is a quest of immortality. Without knowing what is in the Book of the Dead, the deceased will never go to the afterlife. The most important thing for the ancient Egyptian in the afterlife.
The Book of the Dead was a costly proposition, and the decision to purchase one was a difficult and complicated process. There were 186 spells to choose from, and a scroll would be produced based on a person's needs or budget. The priests of the temple would help a person choose which spells would be needed in the afterlife.
Efermat, Wifash, Huit Kabin. Nan Niruat Ashit Wat Hat. Efermat, Viderwad Amad Hod Amit. Tumad Kuhed Yoso. Anyat Aminti.
I sometimes wonder if these Book of the Dead didn't start out in some ways as a little extra moonlighting for money. Once you convince all the rich people that they just have to have this thing, then, I mean, the sky is the limit in how much you could charge.
The creation of one's very own Book of the Dead may have also been a status symbol of the times.
The Book of the Dead would have been quite expensive for any ordinary person to afford. And in fact, we can see this play out archaeologically. We find that the Book of the Dead is only possessed by members of the elite.
Yet this was a change from the earliest days of Egyptian culture. Originally, mummification and an afterlife among the gods was reserved only for the pharaoh. Yet by Ani's time, in the 1200s BCE, the middle classes, and even the poor, hoped for a life after death and were willing to pay for it.
It shows democratization of the afterlife, because originally those texts were only for the king. Then, when we get to the Middle Kingdom, they become accessible to sort of the high nobility. And then we get to the New Kingdom, all of a sudden, a much larger group gets access to these texts.
But in the New Kingdom, the Book of the Dead was written for everyone. It was found in the private tombs. It was found in the nobles' tombs. It was found in the tombs of the artisans.
The spread of belief in the afterlife affected more than just the newly emerging middle class. There are those who believe the Book of the Dead affected Jewish and Christian scripture.
Ancient Christianity owes a great deal to ancient Egypt for its concept of heaven. This makes sense because most of the early Christian fathers were native Egyptians. And so when documents were being written concerning the nature and substance of the afterlife, since these things were not originally written in the Bible, the ancient Egyptians sort of filled in the blanks. The idea of spending one's afterlife with your loved ones in a pleasant place where you could do what you like is the same in both Christianity and in ancient Egyptian religion.
There is even a case to be made that Christian religious imagery owes a debt to the Egyptian Book of the Dead.
It's very clear when we study the history of the New Testament that, in fact, their main competition for the religion of Jesus was the religion of Isis and Osiris and their child, Horus. Many of the early figurations of the Virgin Mary sitting with baby Jesus on her lap are actually based on Isis statues, where Isis is holding Pharaoh, now her symbolic son.
One of the first people to notice the connection between the Book of the Dead and the Bible was none other than Wallace Budge.
The fact remains the Egyptians did believe in one god, Osiris, who had lived upon the earth, had suffered a cruel death, and had risen from the dead. There is no doubt that certain views and religious ideas of Christian sects may be traced directly to the Egyptians.
It's interesting to see how people's ethical beliefs and religious beliefs, no matter where they are from or what century they were sort of written in, all have a great deal in common.
When Ernest Wallace Budge arrives in Egypt in 1887, the country is controlled by a European coalition. Following a Muslim rebellion in 1882, Great Britain and France share control of the country and the vital Suez Canal. Their coalition will control the politics and economy of Egypt for decades. It is an uneasy union, and men like Budge don't make the alliance any easier. Budge has heard rumors of an enormous discovery in Luxor, but his plans to find it put him on a collision course with the new policies of the French head of colonial antiquities, Eugene Grabeau.
Mr. Budge.
Yes?
You will come with me.
I will. What's this about?
It is Monsieur Grabeau. He must see you.
He must he? Ramsay, I'll see you in front of the hotel tomorrow morning at 9.
Monsieur Grabeau had published one very good book on Egyptian religion, but by nature and disposition and training, he was unsuited for the post in which he was thrust.
Sit. You are to wait here.
Here?
And all those who had at heart the welfare of Egypt regretted the appointment.
Pardon the subterfuge, Mr. Budge. I thought it might be unseemly for the director of the Egyptian Museum to be seen in public with a man of your reputation.
Monsieur Grabeau, I presume. My reputation and that of my museum are among my most cherished honors.
Will you join me for tea? I'm afraid you will have to return to the British Museum empty-handed, Mr. Budge. As the keeper of Egypt's antiquities, I must inform you it is my intention to prevent any looting of the nation's treasures.
Monsieur Grabeau, the goal of the British Museum is the preservation of the world's heritage.
My predecessor tells me that on your last trip, you left Egypt with over 1,400 illegal antiquities.
Your predecessor sent nearly the same amount back to the Louvre.
It is illegal to remove antiquities from the country, Mr. Budge. I intend to enforce the law strictly. Anyone suspected of illegal antiquity trading will face painful scrutiny, perhaps even torture.
Threatening the men and women who live here is not the way to gain their trust.
I do not need their trust. I need their obedience. All antiquities belong to the state and to the state's museums.
But these people have made their living from antiquities for generations. Rather than fight them, you should make an alliance with them. They will lead you to even greater fines.
The law is quite clear. All antiquities, whether discovered or not, fall under my jurisdiction. I will not tolerate any deviation from the law, either by you or by your native friends.
Well, I'm sorry we don't see eye to eye.
Do not oppose me, Mr. Budge. I assure you, I make a very unpleasant enemy.
I don't see you as an enemy. Just unpleasant. Good day to you.
Budge knows the French authorities will arrest him if they find him buying antiquities. But he has heard rumors of an enormous discovery of artifacts in the city of Luxor.
This thing's supposed to take me all the way to Luxor, is it?
No, Mr. Budge.
Budge is willing to risk arrest, jail, and even worse, to get the treasure. If an Egyptian wants to ensure himself eternal life, there is only one answer: the Book of the Dead. The Book of the Dead differed with each individual who purchased one.
We have up to 189 chapters that could be in the Book of the Dead. In fact, that's almost never the case that we have all 189. So we find that the scribes, based on their own theology or the preferences of their customers, had a lot of leeway in how they would put the Book of the Dead together.
Now, a spell is a magical utterance or incantation, and the purpose of these was to help the deceased achieve eternal life, or immortality, life after death.
The spells included in the Book of the Dead contained protections from demons that might attack the deceased. There's even a spell to protect the deceased from dying a second time.
Egyptians faced hard physical labor in the afterlife as they plowed the soil and tilled the fields of the gods.
Anut.
Ah, Nanuin Shabti. Mashiet Lav, Ufat Lav.
Chapter 6 allows the deceased, whenever called upon to perform any manual labor, the deceased brings to life little clones of him or herself, and they do all the dirty work. So everybody had to take Chapter 6 with them, because otherwise you'd be there in the underworld without your maid.
The Egyptians even rated some of the spells. Some of them were annotated, truly excellent, good a million times. Now, how a dead person could report back on them, I don't know.
The Egyptians believed that the heart was the most important organ that one possessed, and that was where one's soul lived, that was where one's essence was, where you thought, believed, everything came from there. And thus, they left the heart inside the body because they felt that your heart was necessary as part of the process of getting to the afterlife.
Such an important organ needed extra protection. That protection came in the form of the heart scarab.
The heart scarab is a representation of a scarab beetle. The reason why it's a beetle is that the rising sun in Egypt was symbolized by a beetle, a winged beetle, rising up above the horizon. So this scarab beetle was associated with the idea of the rising sun. The rising sun was a symbol for the rebirth of dead Egyptians.
The scarab would be inscribed on the back with one of the spells that you see in the Book of the Dead, which basically explains why I did not lie, I did not steal, I did not cheat, and my heart is good, it is justified. The heart scarab is a bit like a crib sheet for the deceased.
They were very concerned that their heart might reveal certain things that they had done while they were living that could be injurious to their chances in the afterlife.
Just as important as the text in the Book of the Dead are the lavish illustrations.
The illustrations in the Book of the Dead give a little extra oomph to existing spells. For example, the spell against the demon beetle that might eat you up had a big depiction of the demon beetle on it being fended off by someone. So this would magically help enact the spell and help the deceased fend off this nasty critter that was about to eat him.
Ani's scroll may have taken months, perhaps more than a year, to put together. To an ancient Egyptian, it was well worth the time and effort, for it was meant to last for eternity. One can only imagine the joy Ani must have felt when his scroll was finally complete. There are many scrolls from ancient Egypt, but there are few with the elaborateness and the artistic splendor as the scroll of Ani. No one understands this better than graphics artist and book producer James Wasserman.
When I saw this scroll, my breath was taken away. It was just unbelievable. You know, the color, the richness, the mystery of the images, the power that was obviously in there was phenomenal. At the same time, I was studying the text, trying to learn what the heck the book was supposed to be.
Wasserman created a book out of Ani's scroll, which not only showcases the entire 78-foot parchment, but combines the scroll with its English translation. One can now read Ani's Book of the Dead as Ani himself would have seen it.
If one reads and studies and meditates upon the images and the stories that are in the Book of the Dead, one sees a sense of pride, a sense of belonging. The initiate is seeking to learn and to persevere through tests of his moral character. Here we see Ani and Tutu approaching the most dramatic scene of the entire papyrus, where Ani's heart will be placed on a scale and balanced against the feather of truth of the goddess Maat. If his heart is found too heavy, he will immediately be devoured by this monster, Amit.
Death is the first step towards salvation for the ancient Egyptians. When Ani's wife died, this scroll may not have been placed in her tomb, but it would guide her as well. A single scroll meant to unite a couple in the field of reeds. Three 3,000 years after Ani lived, E.A. Wallace Budge is on a mission. He is told of a rumored treasure in Luxor, the modern name for the ancient city of Thebes. Budge intends to be the first one there.
Thank you, gentlemen. There will be bigger backsheesh on my return.
Thank you.
But Budge's quest is about to be interrupted.
Mr. Budge?
You again. What is it this time?
You are under arrest.
In 1887 Cairo, Egyptologist E.A. Wallace Budge is leaving for Luxor in search of a newly uncovered treasure of ancient artifacts. But Budge's quest is interrupted.
Stop.
You again? What is it this time?
You are under arrest.
By the orders of Eugene Grabeau, the new and zealous guardian of Egyptian antiquities, who is on his own way to Luxor.
Awam! Awam! The boat of Monsieur Grabeau is going to sink in the river.
What?
Ghatban! He calls you from a shot.
Stay here till I return back.
Ramsey learned that Monsieur Grabeau himself was leaving for Luxor that very morning. He told the captain of Grabeau's barge that if he ran ashore, Budge would give him 50 British pounds.
And so I will. A fine piece of work, Ramsey, my boy.
Budge already has a reputation for deception, and scholars are still debating his questionable collecting methods today.
One problem with Budge is that he wasn't an archaeologist. He cut corners and bended rules at a time when you could pretty much buy anything you wanted. And so he was also thought of as being perhaps a little less than ethical in terms of his collecting methods.
I get the impression that Budge, with some of his wheeling and dealing, was much more on the Indiana Jones side than on the side of the little old scholar, you know, who just wants to sit in the back room of the British Museum.
Others suggest that Budge's approach to collecting may have been necessary for the time.
When one considers the number of antiquities that were lost, destroyed, stolen, one can only thank somebody who is a bit of a scoundrel like Budge for having the wherewithal to go in and kind of bribe officials and engage in these bizarre little subterfuges, because he preserved these things.
Then he used his influence, and he used his scholarship at that time. He used his presence and his friendship to the foreign Egyptologist in Egypt to steal many antiquities and take it out of the country and put it at the British Museum. That was not fair.
Budge starts at last towards Luxor, still one step ahead of his nemesis, Grabeau. The treasure he seeks is said to include rare pieces of an Egyptian Book of the Dead.
When I arrived in Luxor, I found that the dealers had indeed collected many valuable things from the tombs at Western Thebes.
No. This is antiquity.
Antique? Okay.
The natives treated the government's claim to all antiquities in Egypt with contempt. Antiquities were plentiful.
Count. Ashes bound. That.
Ducatair.
£5.
But money was not.
Shakram. Oh. Shakran, Afan.
Budge could only imagine what these ruins looked like in the time of the pharaohs. Some 3,000 years earlier, when Luxor is known as Thebes, a scribe named Ani has commissioned his own Book of the Dead, at the cost of half a year's salary. Its value to him in the afterlife will soon be tested. We have no way of knowing how Ani died, but we have a good idea of how he was buried. As a royal scribe, Ani was part of the elite. His entombment would have been elaborate and expensive.
We know there were different, shall we say, price ranges for mummification. Poor people would choose a mummification form that was really very low rent. The poor person would be taken by his or her family and buried in the sand outside somebody else's tomb or pyramid. And the hope there was that the poor person could sort of follow along. There was kind of a trickle down. If you got the high-end funeral, your mummification could take up to 272 days. You got all the best coffins and sarcophagi.
After mummification, the deceased is placed on a boat-shaped sledge pulled by oxen and taken to his tomb in one of the large cemeteries that dotted the western shore of the Nile. Illustrations of Egyptian funerals show not only grieving relatives, but also musicians, dancers, priests, and professional mourners. The final ritual in the mummification burial is the placement of the Book of the Dead. Now the deceased has everything he needs for his journey to a mysterious new world.
بشف آثور اون شویتی شد ان پخیس
Ancient Egypt are buried in elaborate tombs, from the first pyramids built in 2600 BCE to the famous Valley of the Kings, where generations of royal families were buried for five centuries. But the elite and middle class of ancient Egypt had their own cemeteries and individual tombs, and these tombs, with their rich hoards of jewelry and goods, are for centuries the targets of tomb raiders. At the time Ernest Wallace Budge arrives in Luxor, tomb robbing is an ancient profession handed down from father to son for generations.
Many natives dealt openly in antiquities. They detested the officials of the Service of Antiquities, for they were convinced that their one object was to get hold of antiquities, not to preserve in the Museum of Cairo, but to sell on their own behalf. They were ready to deal with anyone who was not a servant of the Egyptian government.
I am selling to you because you bought from my family before. But you must not lead the Frenchmen here. Understood?
I will not. I can promise you that, Hassan.
Budge is often rather vague about exactly where he found things, and that's because he was dealing with antiquities dealers who would tell him secondhand where they might have found them.
Budge was most likely taken to Kurna, a village on the west bank of the Nile, very close to the Valley of the Kings. Here, the inhabitants have built their home atop a cemetery of nobles, which they have systematically plundered throughout the 19th century.
These are the best treasures.
19th dynasty. I may be able to give you a good price. Hassan, what do you want for it all?
200 pounds.
Done. Can I look at that?
It is trash. Broken treasure. It is worth nothing. Take it.
Oh, my God.
The seal is unbroken. Gentlemen, I believe we are looking at a document that has lain undisturbed for 30 or more centuries. Hail to you, Ra, creator of the gods. Ramsay, what we are seeing here is an untouched, pristine Egyptian Book of the Dead made for Ani, scribe to the Pharaoh.
To an Egyptologist like Budge, a scroll is a fascinating artifact. But to an ancient Egyptian like Ani, the scroll is the key to life in the hereafter.
Well, the Egyptians believed that the afterlife was a dangerous place, and this probably symbolized the crisis of death. For the Egyptians who loved life, death was a tearing of the fabric of society.
To the ancient Egyptians, death is only the beginning of a journey fraught with peril. In 1887, Sir Ernest Wallace Budge is in Egypt collecting antiquities for the British Museum. On a trip to Luxor, site of the ancient city of Thebes, he discovers the 78-foot-long scroll of Ani.
What we are seeing here is an untouched, pristine Egyptian Book of the Dead made for Ani.
In ancient Egypt, a copy is buried with a mummy as a guide to the life beyond the grave. The Egyptians believe that after death, a person awakes in the underworld, or Duat. It is in this mysterious place that the dead person faces a series of challenges and struggles.
The greatest challenge was to overcome and not be defeated by the demonic forces that lived in the afterlife and threatened the gods of the underworld as much as the dead themselves.
For the Egyptians, death was a crisis to be overcome, but they were optimistic, so they believed that it could be overcome, but not without a series of trials or travails.
Part of the Book of the Dead illustrates a dangerous world where the deceased is threatened by terrifying beings.
When hieroglyphs were used in a magical book like the Book of the Dead, they became magically active. You might liken it to a video game where you had to go through a series of episodes where you would have to fight off enemies or go past clever obstacles. In fact, they would damage hieroglyphs that had a threatening aspect because they might kind of get out of control. So for example, one of the most common hieroglyphs is in the form of a horned viper, one of the most deadly snakes in the world. It's used a lot in spells and different texts, so they would chop it in half so the snake couldn't leap off the wall and attack the owner.
But if the hieroglyph was not damaged, it could come alive and attack. For Ani, his protection are the spells from the Book of the Dead.
Aniji Irak Pireyuf.
But the Egyptian afterlife also includes allies.
Based on texts like the Book of the Dead, we believe that the deceased would have immediately been greeted by the god Anubis, who was known as also opener of ways and the guide of the dead through the afterlife.
Anubis is a very prominent god in the netherworld and also in connection with the actual mummification and ritual burial of the dead. He always appears with the head of a canine, and he's identified with the jackals and the other kind of wild canines that existed in Egypt and tend to live on the fringes of the valley where the cemeteries are. So there was always a kind of close association between these wild dogs and the world of the dead.
The god Anubis is both a guardian and a guide for the deceased. It's his job to make sure that you get to judgment safely and that you can get to everywhere that you need to go.
One of the most important chapters in the Book of the Dead is a mysterious ritual called the Opening of the Mouth.
What I love about this ritual is they didn't just symbolically open the mouth, but they also opened the eyes and the ears, which is very much a philosophical statement.
The opening of the mouth ceremony was a spiritual awakening of the body. So once the deceased had died, his senses were shut down. And this would allow the body to become a vessel for the soul of the deceased, so they could see, they could taste offerings, they could smell incense, they could hear the prayers that were being said, and then they could actually actively use objects like the Book of the Dead to help in their journey through the afterlife.
The dead person has a goal in the underworld, to reach the field of reeds or field of offerings. A blessed place where the deceased can live for eternity. But to get to the field of offerings is a long, difficult journey fraught with many dangers. Any one of them can jeopardize Ani's chances for paradise. In 1887, Ernest Wallace Budge is in Luxor, and only one step away from the French and Egyptian authorities. His unorthodox methods clearly get results, but they make powerful enemies.
Look at this, Ramsay. Over 3,000 years old, and the colors on the scroll still glow.
It is almost as if he is still alive. Are all books of the dead like this?
No. No, and I've seen my share. This is the discovery of a lifetime. Or several lifetimes. So we better make sure this gets home safely.
Aywa, aywa, marhaba, marhaba, Effendi. Mr. Budge, will you join me and my family for some coffee?
Budge is almost ready to go when he's interrupted by some very unwelcome guests.
Turkish coffee for all the workers. Coffee, coffee.
Coffee. No, thank you, Mr. Budge. I'm far too busy arresting antiquities thieves. Omar, tell the men to confiscate all these items.
These belong to me.
These belong to the nation of Egypt,
and you belong in jail. We've already arrested all the other treasure hunters in this neighborhood. But it looks like we've saved the best till last.
See here, Grebo. These men are employees of the British government.
Please be quiet, Mr. Budge. You have made me look like a fool once, but you will not do it again.
Make sure the caravan is loaded in the morning and ready to leave for Cairo.
With the scroll in the hands of authorities, Budge knows it could be lost to the world forever, or worse, stolen and cut up for souvenirs on the black market. The very methods that Budge supports could now lead to the destruction of his greatest discovery. Wallace Budge discovers the magnificent scroll of Ani, only to have the authorities confiscate it and throw him in jail.
I find myself in most dire circumstances, jailed in Luxor, accused by the French of all people of being a tomb raider. And all this after having discovered perhaps the greatest find of my career, an ancient burial scroll belonging to a scribe named Ani. Rich in color and full of fantastic images, thousands of years old, I believe it represents perhaps the first time man has expressed his spiritual beliefs in writing. Truly a profound discovery. Of course, I need time to study it, in order to fully grasp its meaning. Sadly, I am unlikely to ever hold it in my hands again.
For Ani, his Book of the Dead is now a roadmap to the Hall of Judgment, where the gods will determine whether he deserves to live eternity in the Field of Reeds. But getting there can be treacherous. The spells included in the Book of the Dead contain protection from demons that might attack the deceased.
See, Miuminava, Naka, Deja, Madata!
One spell was protection against a giant beetle called the Asharu, which might eat the deceased. The underworld is a strange place. The Egyptians thought of it as a confrontation with chaos.
After creation, there was this island of rightful order created. But a large part of the universe remains uncreated and chaotic and therefore irrational. A lot of the Book of the Dead deals with this type of irrational magic, of fighting irrational forces with irrational means.
3,000 years later, in 1887, the Scroll of Ani is now in the hands of authorities. And Ernest Wallace Budge has his own obstacles to overcome.
The sense of helplessness is overwhelming. Knowing that every moment I sit here in this wretched cell, the Scroll of Ani is further from my reach.
Budge al-Inglizi wa Hussam al-Sariq, antuma hurran. انطلقا من هنا انطلقا
راح يعني ما راح ليش How did you get us out of here?
أنا ما شفتك.
بخشيش.
Experience has taught Budge that the scroll may not be safe, even from the guards themselves.
They know the scroll is worth more if they break it up into 20 smaller pieces. Grabeau won't even notice anything is missing until all the pieces are sold.
Oh dear, this is worse than I had imagined. Once it leaves that storehouse, it will never be put back together again. Any ideas?
I did notice something. That hotel. The storehouse is built against its wall.
Wallace Budge has always had a mixed reputation. Even then, he was notorious for the levels that he would go to in order to acquire things for the British Museum.
Budge reveals in his autobiography how he develops a plan.
Now, among the houses that were sealed and guarded was a small one that abutted on the wall of the garden of the old Luxor Hotel. This house was a source of considerable anxiety to me, for in it they had stored the Papyrus of Ani. A talk with the hotel manager was my only hope.
So you see, the treasures of Egypt are about to be destroyed, or at the very least, shipped away to France, all due to an unfortunate misunderstanding with Monsieur Grabeau. However, the treasure can be saved. In fact, some small treasure might even find its way onto the walls of your inn, and only certain accommodations would be necessary.
What kind of accommodations?
Budge hires several local men to tunnel through the hotel wall and into the storeroom, holding the scroll of Ani.
It's astonishing how fast they work.
Men like these have been digging out treasures from tombs in their basements for centuries. A 50-year-old hotel wall means nothing to them.
With only a night before the scroll of Ani is to be moved by authorities, will Budge's bold plan be enough, or will his discovery of a lifetime be lost forever? In ancient Egypt, life doesn't end with death. In fact, the ancient Egyptians believed that death was just the beginning of a long and arduous journey. A journey that could end with salvation or annihilation. Ani hopes his Book of the Dead will bring him to a life in paradise. But he has many tests yet to come, and anything can happen. If the wandering soul follows the directions in the scroll, he eventually finds his way to a final challenge, the Hall of Judgment. Here he must face 42 separate gods in front of 42 separate doors. In front of each god, he must deny having committed a particular sin. It is one of the greatest challenges of the afterlife.
If you don't know the correct answers, the correct thing to say at this point, you presumably are not going to be able to get through that gate and pass successfully into the next life.
These 42 commandments that Ani must deny having broken have come to be called the negative confessions.
It's a litany of things that the deceased didn't do. So he says, I did not go out and murder anybody. I didn't steal anything. I didn't fool around with somebody's wife. I didn't do this, that, and the other thing. It's very informative and revealing about what probably a lot of Egyptians did do.
But chances are, only through the spells in the Book of the Dead would you make it through the negative confessions.
One should not confuse this with the notion of confession and repentance. This is really a magical incantation to wipe the board clean of whatever you might have done on Earth.
One interesting fact is that most of the Ten Commandments can be found in the negative confessions. Could the Ten Commandments, written several hundred years after the Book of the Dead, be lifted from the negative confessions?
There's nothing in the Book of the Dead that says that there's only one God. There is nothing that says that only one God may be worshipped. However, almost all of the Ten Commandments, the things that are prohibited, by the Ten Commandments do appear in the Book of the Dead.
Egypt was the home of Moses. It's easy to see a variety of ways in which the Book of the Dead and Egyptian culture have influenced the Bible.
Whether or not the negative confessions are the source of the Ten Commandments, the Egyptians believed that a person must have lived a good life.
There are a lot of gods who would say, well, what did you do? And they would pose, it's almost like going through an exam. So they would pose test questions to the deceased to see if they had done right or wrong.
You have to open every gate. And these gates were not easy to enter. It was guarded with this huge scorpions, and you have to answer their questions or they will eat you.
Ani faces each god detailed in the Book of the Dead, gods with terrifying names like Swallower of Spirits and Breaker of Bones.
Awasif, Pira, Miana,
Anij Anata.
With each correct response from the Book of the Dead, Ani moves forward through the doors. Only after the final door will the soul of Ani meet the god Horus, the hawk-headed son of Isis and Osiris, who will escort Ani to his final test in the Hall of Judgment. The decisive moment in the Egyptian Book of the Dead is called the Weighing of the Heart.
The ancient Egyptians visualized many challenges waiting for them in the afterlife. One of the most important was to successfully undergo this judgment before the tribunal of Osiris and be found worthy to become one of the blessed dead.
Amahayipi Mawata.
Hasidatak. Amawanatak.
The dead person's heart is the symbol of his intelligence and his emotions and even his mind.
The heart is, of course, where your essence lay and where your sort of good and bad deeds were.
The deceased must hand his heart scarab amulet to Anubis to be weighed against a single feather of the goddess Ma'at.
Ma'at was a goddess who is basically the personification of truth, justice, order, balance.
The heart could not be heavier than truth, but it couldn't be lighter either. It had to balance out. It's interesting that those phrases also continue to exist in our language. Now you talk about somebody being lighthearted or heavy-hearted.
No deceased wanted to be stuck just relying on their own purity of heart. Hence the Book of the Dead, with the appropriate magic spells that kind of make up the difference, help you get through by the skin of your teeth. But there is an option that you might not pass the test, and if you are not making good use of your Book of the Dead magic spells, you would be thrown to the monster Amit. She is the devourer of souls, the devourer of the dead.
The job of this monstrous creature, which combined a crocodile, a lion, a hippopotamus, ferocious creatures like that, was to instantly devour any deceased person who was found guilty there in the Hall of Judgment.
If Amit eats your heart, you cease to exist. For the ancient Egyptians, that was the scariest thing. It wasn't punishment, it was not being able to exist at all.
The stone heart scarab, which represents the dead man's heart, is now put to the final test, a test for eternity or oblivion.
Thank you.
When Ani reaches the Hall of Judgment, his trials in the Land of the Dead are nearly over. Only one test is left for Ani, one which will determine his fate for eternity. After losing the scroll of Ani to Egyptian authorities, Budge is now attempting to get it back.
The house where the antiquities were stored abutted on the wall of the Luxor Hotel. Workmen began to dig under the wall and cut through the soft, unbaked mud bricks into the house.
I'm telling you, I heard something.
No one could get in here with us guarding the place.
Make sure the caravan is loaded in the morning and ready to leave for Cairo. Without fail.
It seemed unwise to rely overmuch on the silence of our operations, and we therefore arranged to give the police and the soldiers a meal, for they were both hungry and thirsty.
Gentlemen! I have been ordered back to England, I'm afraid.
Many will miss you and your little gifts.
Budge was a very strange character. You have a good side and bad side of Budge. The good side is his publication. The bad side is what he did to steal from Bishop.
And I would like to present to you gentlemen a little token dinner representing my gratitude and friendship. Ramsay!
Tfaddalu, tfaddalu. Tfaddalu ya jamaat.
Eat well, gentlemen.
Budge knows if he is caught, his career will be ruined and he will likely spend many years in an Egyptian prison. But to him, it is well worth the risk to recover such a priceless masterpiece.
Whilst they were eating happily, man after man went into the house and brought out piece by piece and box by box everything which was of the slightest value commercially. In this way, we saved the papyrus of Ani.
3,000 years earlier, the Book of the Dead is believed to be invaluable to Ani. It is his one guide through the trials of the weighing of the heart and his one chance at eternal paradise.
Ibi muati, mikufsi ari dushiwa, miriuka ari maba, irimaki midushi, digarik arai agasnata.
This was a spell that literally told the heart not to rat on you. So the spell was designed to keep the heart from saying, oh, by the way, you fooled around with somebody else's wife, or you stole something, or something like this. You're just supposed to say, no, no, you were just fine and dandy, no problems.
Some people have suggested that the heart scarab might have been a way to cheat one's way through the weighing. But I think that it represents more the concept that a person needs to be emotionally calm and ready for that to happen. You know, he needs to be one with his emotions, because the heart for the Egyptian was the seat of his emotions.
Helps its owner finally pass the weighing of the heart in the Great Hall of Judgment. His journey over, his ordeals complete, he can now enter paradise in the blessed field of reeds. In 1887, Ernest Wallace Budge is about to face the end of his own perilous journey.
Guard!
Enhab, I ask you! Enhab!
Open that door! Bouge-toi, vite! Enhab,
enter!
Stand aside!
Go and check the caravan.
It has been an Arab.
Ah! It's gone. It's all gone.
By dawn, Budge and his treasures are already on a barge headed for Cairo, and eventually London. By December of 1887, Sir Ernest Wallace Budge has returned to the British Museum. With him is the complete scroll of Ani.
For the first time, museum goers will be able to examine the entire Book of the Dead.
Though what Budge would do to it is as controversial as the man himself.
When he got it back to the British Museum, he cut it into sections that he could work with. He arranged for it to be pasted to wooden boards so that it could be translated. From a technological point of view, one can almost forgive him. But on the other hand, he destroyed the integrity of the papyrus forever.
Budge spends the rest of his life at the British Museum as a keeper of Egyptian antiquities. Most of his 140 books are still in print, and even those raise controversy.
He wrote a lot of popular books, but he wrote them quickly and without a lot of care. And in fact, his translations were already out of date when they were published in the 1890s.
Budge has a very mixed reputation amongst Egyptologists. He produced a lot, but his scholarship was not always considered sound. And his ethics of collection certainly left a great deal to be desired.
I myself, until today, read his books. His books are very important. I think that the only bad thing about Budge that he did steal antiquities.
Were it not for the massive amount of material that he published, perhaps flawed as it was, there would not be the interest in Egyptology and ancient cultures that there is today.
He has done more to popularize the Egyptian Book of the Dead and to popularize the notion of the Egyptian afterlife than perhaps any other scholar and any other text that was published.
Whether Budge was a scholar, an adventurer, or even a thief, it is clear that the Scroll of Ani is his greatest contribution to the world of Egyptology. He never makes a greater find, nor has anyone ever discovered any other scrolls as artistic or complete as Ani's Book of the Dead.
I wonder what the young man in the picture would think of all this.
I don't know. I suspect he wouldn't mind. Ani wished for immortality. With the scroll in the museum, the name of Ani will be read and remembered by millions of people.
I suspect you're right.
And wherever Ani is, I hope he can give us his blessings.
I think as long as we have human questions about the meaning of life and death, the Book of the Dead is actually going to remain quite relevant. The ancient Egyptians wrote that book not because they longed for death, but because they adored life and they wanted it to go on. The Book of the Dead imagines that the most blessed place you could be is right here on earth.
Ultimately, the Egyptian Book of the Dead is a guide for the living. A guide of how one should live life on earth. A life of morals and ethics in order to obtain an afterlife. But the mysteries of the ancient Egyptians remain. These are the mysteries that lie at the heart of the Egyptian Book of the Dead. These mysteries of life, of death, and of the hereafter remain eternal. Mysteries that can only be understood by faith, hope, works of the imagination and the heart.